personal background was the foundation to creating Shameless, and a huge amount of my autobiography has gone into it. But quite a lot of the people within the Shameless family aren't actually my family. They're just kind of composites of people I know. Like Ian isn't a member of my family. He's like someone in my family, but also like a mate from school. So it's just important characteristics that make the most dynamic character to fit within this family for the sake of getting a good dynamic for the show. A lot of people think I'm lip. They kind of pin me down to lip, and that's part of me is lip, but a huge amount of him is not me. You know, I was never that kind of totally outspoken, nowhere near as brave as he is, but I was the kid who did the homework for other people for money. I wish I'd been, he's the character I would have liked to have been at that time. So loads of characteristics that he's got are kind of wish fulfillment on my part. I guess I'm closest to him, but he's not me, no. I was quite surprised at the popularity of Shameless, and surprised moreover at the cross-section of people it appealed to. And you know, lots of older people who watch it because they think it's warm. They find it warm, even though no one scene can direct you to understand that particularly. The overall feel of the whole thing is warm. And the fact that we have blowjobs, we have sex, we have bad language, we have just about everything. So, you know, it's about derelict ambitions, I guess. It just flies over the radar of quite a lot of old people I know like it. And my wife's auntie, who's arguably one of the poshest people I've ever met, it doesn't matter to her that people are fucking on the tables, blowjobs, or anything like that. It just doesn't matter to her because she likes the warmth of the family, the unconditional adhesion of that family just makes it feel warm. I knew we'd hit the right note when something awful happened within a scene and somebody laughed. And it was basically Lip laughing at Ian when he found out how disastrous it was for him to be gay in an estate like this. When Lip laughed, when Lip decided at one point he would find it funny, that kind of represented the real state of the kind of family we lived in. Because you got over misfortune by finding a way out of it, and you found a way out of it by basically taking the piss out of everybody.
How can that be good for you? All that?
Do you know what's not funny? You ever...
Anybody before Cash?
One.
Who?
I'm not telling you.
And actually, up the arse. Because, look, I'm not taking the piss. I've gone through a toilet roll, and that's just one finger, barely up the ring. Scream the house down. Do you get used to that? Can you? The whole point of the digestive system's about one-way traffic.
It just is.
What?
It just is. Like we're only given lungs so we could buck his marker.
A scene I particularly like from the first series of Shameless, and it's the end of one scene into another, and it's when Frank has basically talked his way into Sheila's house. And he's predatory, because he knows she's agoraphobic on maximum benefits. She can cook, and she likes sex. And what he doesn't know, till he gets into bed with her, basically, is that she likes to slip in one with a strap on. And it's the scene that follows that, when Frank emerges from upstairs in the clothes of Sheila's ex-husband. And, you know, just walking like he'll never walk straight again in his life, and her having to put a cushion down under him. I thought that was fantastically... I think that got a huge laugh from the audience, and it, because it kind of... It taught Frank a lesson. And it wasn't a lesson that he would learn from forever, but it was just one that, you know, he got his comeuppance that day in the best, the most spectacular, the most shameless way. I loved that.
Sit yourself down.
When did this get done?
Nipped down and stuck the chops on a low light about 7. Snuck back about 10 to peel the spuds.
What time is it? Fuck's sake, what did you slip us?
Just natural tiredness, Frank. It's probably jet lag. You went to sleep, just staring. Look at the good it's done you. Look like you've got blusher on.
I think one of the stories we pulled off best was the paedophile story in episode 4, because it's really not a comedy story. It's not, you know, the abduction of a child isn't funny, and the huge attempt by the family to try and reinstate that child in order to prevent Debbie being perceived as somebody who's a little bit loopy, I thought we did fantastically well, because we did what we said we would do, which was actually to take the piss out of not paedophilia, not paedophile victims, but the nature of a mob as it reacts to a crisis.
There he is! Yeah.
You. Oh, God!
Where's the kid?
Oh, God! Oh, God.
Oh, the kid!
You are scum!
Where did they get over?
Oh, God! Oh, God. Get him! Get him! It's him! They're all lying! Get him! It's animals!
Come on, let's search his flat.
Let's go! Come on, let's go! Let's go! What's
so all that about?
Fuck knows.
Lads, it just keeps a confession out of Ice Cream Alec. He's admitted to dipping his knob in the tubs.
He took little Jodie!
We don't know till he comes out of theatre.
I think what I love about Frank is that he believes every word he says. You know, he's never paid a penny's tax in his life, but he feels he's got a right to comment on the government about the state of the nation. And I think that total kind of psychopathology of somebody who he really thinks he's a contributor to a society, and there isn't a single strand, there isn't a grain of achievement he's pulled off that ought to justify that. But I love that he's such a liar, such a perfect liar, because he believes every single word he says. And I think him, you know, kind of ranting on about Tony Blair, you know, the pay rises for nurses and the state of the nation and immigrants and all that, I think he just believes everyone. He wants to be a balanced bloke. But even within a sentence, you structure a sentence so that he doesn't even know what's coming at the end. He's no idea that he's just contradicted himself. And I love him being so passionate when he's pissed.
You say what you like about Saddam. He'd have had that twisted bastard melted down. Tell Tony Blair, that's how you get my vote, you know. Pasty-faced gimp. Write that down.
The big key to liking Frank is the fact that the kids actually would defend him to the death. And when Debbie kisses him, and Debbie just kind of nips in there, and she has so much affection for him. When he was taken to France in episode 2, and she thought he might be dead, she was just absolutely beside herself because she'd lost an icon. And to her, he's a fixable. I think she sees somebody who's fixable. And I think all the kids have worked around him for so long that actually he doesn't enter their orbit at any time. They just know how to dance completely around him. And I think their hope is that they will eventually make a decent bloke out of him. But of course, then we wouldn't have a series.